pizza.
Hello and welcome, DBS family. Today we are here with the On The Rocks executive chef, Chef K, and I'm your host, Anella. So Chef K, how are you feeling today? Are you excited? Are you ready?
Man, I'm overjoyed. I mean, it's a progress, it's something that we've been trying to put myself up to and try my best to get back to our old age and try and go back and ask my father and then what they do back in their time, you know? So it's basically, I'm very excited if you want to ask. Yeah, I am very much.
Okay, great. So today we are going to be making a fish broth.
That is right.
Right, and this is a recipe from your father.
Yeah, this is a recipe from, not from my dad actually, it's from his mom.
Okay.
Yeah, so basically it's a really easy, fast recipe, honestly. Consists of starch, a protein, and veg. Short and simple, all right? But we're going to try our best to make it look a little bit gourmet. That's a little bit gourmet. We're not going to do it too much, but we're going to do a little bit gourmet, all right?
Okay, I'm ready.
And
let's
then
we have
one more thing. It's one more thing that we're going to be using today. We're going to be making some furring ball, but it's a roasted saltfish. So that's a little appetizer of the day before we enter the main. But guys, excited though.
That sounds amazing. That sounds incredible. All right. So the fish we'll be using today is going to be...
It is going to be my favorite fish of all time. I know most of some Lucians will... A lot of people might not disagree with me, but I love tuna, especially tuna head. It's really amazing. So we're going to be using some tuna head fish broth. I'm going to be obviously add a little bit of tail and a little bit of steak pieces to it as well.
Okay.
Alright, so this is going to be it.
Alright, so let's get started.
Alright.
What's the first step to making this fish broth?
Alright, first step is honestly, is to always start unpeeling those vegetables because that's the one that gives us the most trouble.
Mm-hmm.
Now, a secret and a fun trick of doing it is, I like to have a recipe. Let's just get, you're going to let out the ground first and then we're going to go to up to the bottom. So we're going to do the root first and then we're going to go up to the tree.
I like that.
So we're going to first, you're going to help me as well. So you're going to, this is your dashing, we call that dashing, guys. All right, we're going to take our small dashing. You know what I'm saying? Choose a knife of your choice.
Okay, you have a lot of different options. I think I'll stick with this one for today. It's heavy.
Very much so. It's German steel. All right. So we're going to go and just start off with cutting out. Let's cut out a little head there. Lovely. And we're going to just move this box off right over here. I'm struggling. All right, so now afterwards, we're just going to be peeling it really easy. It's not really hard. Just take a knife and lightly go down on it.
These are some sharp knives.
Yeah, a little careful. Mm-hmm. All right. She's holding it properly. Yeah, give her that. All right, so we're just going to keep going and peeling that bottom of it. So.
Okay.
Nice.
So, do you have any plans this Juniquail season? What are you getting ready for?
Work. my boys and I is most likely going to go down the coast.
Mm-hmm.
Most likely might do a little meeting, a little bit of drinking.
A lot
of drinking.
we have to celebrate, right?
Yeah, responsible, the most important thing.
Responsibly.
Of it. Yeah, so what I'm going to do as well is we're going to have most likely go down south, look for a little bit of pigs.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, one of my friends is a butcher as well. Farmer, so it's, you're here, you can invite us to basically come down Denry for us to have some pig, which I'm excited for actually.
Ooh, you have some exciting plans.
Yeah, a little bit of a little too much.
Mm-hmm. Are you guys gonna be having any events here at your workplace here on the rocks?
So far, honestly, we might not be having a Juniquail event, which I'm possibly trying my best to do right now. I'm honestly trying my best to put in a progress, hopefully just see about our Instagram and be updated. But I might go outside, and I might do a big brawl with seafood. It'll be a big seafood brawl with crab, some crayfish, potatoes, corn, a whole bunch of stuff in it. So it's gonna be lit. Hopefully I get that sorted out, I get my pan delivered down here on time because we want to get a nice big pot. So hopefully that could be done. Hopefully that's a go.
Okay, alright.
Yeah. Alright, so since you do this already, what we're gonna do as well, we're gonna take this nice pan there with some water already. Alright, what we're gonna do as well. And come up, and that's the nice water in it already. And what we're going to do is cut it nicely. The reason why we're going to cut it so is because, like I said, we're going to be a little bit of gourmet. Just a little bit gourmet. Most times, they'll probably just cut it and just put it in nice cubes. We're going to just give some nice circular round cuts, easy like this.
Nothing hard.
You don't have to do it professionally. You don't have to do it perfect. Just nice rough circle cuts. Alright. Okay, she's a chef, I see. Okay.
I've been learning. This is episode 3, and so far I've been learning a lot. Last episode we learned with Chef Dawn how to use our knife and amazing. Chop up some onions, etc.
Ooh, so, you chop up onions?
Yes, yes.
Alright, lovely.
So we're getting there. So how long have you been the executive chef here for?
I have been the executive chef here for at least roughly probably like 2 or 3 months.
Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It was a fun experience when I just came in at first because, you know, I have to change menus, create things that people would like. Mm-hmm. And we try our best to create, I try my best to use as much local things that I could use as well, and also give people an international feel of it. So basically, our beef we use are actually from Scotland, and it's grass-fed cow.
Okay.
And it's grounded from ribeye as well. And we do have grass-fed ribeye steak. Not everybody may like it, but it's really nutritious as well. And mm-hmm. beneficial. So yeah, and we have variety of stuff like tacos and mm-hmm. We are known for our burgers though.
The burgers? Yeah. Okay, I saw it on the menu.
Yeah, we have a smash burger, and we also have what we call a Kraken burger. Mm-hmm. Basically a squid basically taking over. So what we're gonna help you gonna help me with today.
Okay.
You're gonna help me peel those potatoes. Okay.
Can I use the same knife or do I have to switch?
You can use whichever knife you feel comfortable.
Okay. Let's try this one out. So just to peel these.
Yeah. I was gonna give her a peeler, but we're gonna go back then. Back then I don't think we had any peeler.
No, we didn't. Right. Everything.
Yep, out a little bit. Lovely.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely been using a knife before.
I don't wanna say too much.
Okay.
I gotta be secretive about it.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So before you started here, did you get formal education?
Yeah, so I actually was taught, I used to attend Babylon Secondary School. Mm-hmm. I was in food and nutrition at the time. And there was this, Sanders came around to school basically helping kids out, learn a few stuff and ask them, actually just inspire, basically let kids know how it is to become a chef.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore you can, all right, do you really want to get into that field or do you not really want to get into that field?
Mm-hmm.
And then to me it was just fascinating that somebody who came from nothing eventually became something out of this one field. Mm-hmm. And he ended up doing something he loved and making people happy, which I love to do as well.
Mm-hmm.
And from secondary school, Sandals basically just kidnapped me. Honestly, that's a funny part. Sandals, Ran, honestly, thank you guys again for the opportunity that you gave me.
Mm-hmm.
There's this HP program. And I mean, my mom couldn't afford to go to send me to Alpha Louis at the time. But Sandals said the opportunity, and I was very eager in the training when they came to the school, basically telling the kids that the sous chef there spoke to the executive chef, and I got a phone call from Sanders who come down to the HP program.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a very fun experience. I mean, me being an HP, which basically means training, I'm in a training program, and mm-hmm. me running an entire breakfast station buffet for Sanders. And Sanders Grand is a huge hotel.
Yes, it incredibly is.
It was really fun, honestly, as well. So what you're gonna do for me right now,
mm-hmm.
same style, you're gonna just cut it in like this, same style, same motion, easy like this.
Okay.
All right.
Some thin round slices.
Nice. So actually as well, it's gonna help it cook faster as well. So you try your best to make your food cook faster, as you most likely hungry. When you're hungry, you want to make that food cook as fast as possible.
Mm-hmm.
Alright, so cutting everything the same size and the thin as possible is basically helping cook faster as well. We're not gonna get it too thin that it melts too fast, therefore you can't eat it. Alright? So
right.
We're gonna go now to the man of the hour.
The green thing.
All right.
Okay.
All right. So we're going to be using at least basically just 5 of them. I mean, we could use all of it.
Mm-hmm.
But we're just going to just, I mean, the basic way to peel green fig is cut off the head and then the tail.
Mm-hmm.
And then you take your knife slightly like this, straight down the middle.
Okay.
All right.
Mm-hmm.
All right, whilst we unpeeling as well, we're basically going to be doing this right there with our hands, with our thumb, and guide it through it, lovely. And we're just going to glide our hands through it short and simple and very easy like this. You want to be too aggressive on it because therefore it can break.
Just some light pulling.
Lovely.
Mm-hmm.
And
is this... Is this one of these recipes that, you know, you normally make around Junikoil time?
Well, if you are true Saint Lucian, like a real Saint Lucian, you will know this one thing that we call like man food. All right, this is man food. This is man sauce that gives you the energy and the thrill to be a solution and to make more solutions, all right? So it's a very fun thing that we usually, men usually drink. Most likely on Saturdays, you drink it beer with your friends.
Mm-hmm.
It's something that will fill your stomach.
Right.
And it's, everything from it is organic and everything here on from this broth is look, basically plant locally here.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, you know exactly where your thing's coming from. You get your fish freshly from the waters, or buy the fresh from the fisheries. And it's honestly a very easy and fast thing to make.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very much so joyful because you have all that sauce and all that flavor from the fish in this one pot.
Oh, it broke!
It happens. So we're going to do as well. We can continue. Oh, we just getting started, girl. Okay, we're going to cut the hair.
Oh, all right. We're going to do all
turn,
of these.
Yeah, we're just going to do those two more and that's it. Lovely.
Chef K.
Yes, ma'am.
Mm-hmm. Chef Nelly's gonna come in the kitchen and show you how it's done today.
I could tell. She knows what she's doing.
But you're the professional.
It's what they say.
All right.
So while you do them do this, I'm just basically gonna cut them. So we're not gonna cut the green figs different though. Because
mm-hmm.
green figs cooks really fast, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we're gonna cut it like this.
Some bigger squares. Some
nice bigger, yeah. I like my feet. I love my figs. I like to taste my figs.
Okay? Mm-hmm.
I like to taste it. I don't need to melt too fast. I like to taste it. I'm going to just rush to put it in the water real quick because as you can see, it's going to be changing color, which we don't want to change color too much.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Okay.
Okay, I see you. One, two, that's three. Nice, evenly sized pieces into the water.
And this one, last one.
The last one right here.
Right.
So after you're done with this last one, we're going to just clean up.
Mm-hmm.
And then we're going to go down to our seasonings.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Okay, so you normally use local herb seasonings for
only.
Right.
If you use anything else, basil kind of is plant locally, but
mm-hmm.
we want to use organic lotion. So we want to use our local seasoning peppers, we want to use our parsley, we want to use our white onions, we want to use even our garlic as well. And of course, if you have seasoning lotion and you don't have margarine in your food, that's a problem. So we have to make sure that is a must.
Okay.
All right. So we're going to use a little bit of herbal seasoning with Maggi as well. I mean, most people might use the fish seasoning, but I don't really like the fish seasoning because it has a little too much salt in it.
Mm-hmm.
I want to make it a little bit healthy and much enjoyable, all right? So now we're going to take this boy, and we're going to season the water as yet.
Mm-hmm.
All right?
We're going to put salt in it.
Yes, so when you get to a boil, the best time to add your water, anything when you're boiling with water, the best part to add is when it's at 100 degrees because you want to add the salt and see that salt evaporate immediately.
Mm-hmm.
All right? So we put this bad boy on my flat top right here. All right.
Are you gonna get things started? Get things rolling.
We'll get rolling and get hot. All right.
Okay. Okay, guys. Our grand provisions are in the pots and they're boiling. We're gonna go for a break now, and we'll see you guys soon. Bye. Welcome back, guys. So our grand provisions have boiled and we're ready to start prepping our seasonings, etc. So right now we're gonna start by chopping up our peppers.
All right, so what we're gonna do really fast and really easy is that people just move the feet in the peppers.
Mm-hmm.
My grandmother, if you do that to my grandmother before, that is a war. Do not move the woman seeds in the peppers.
Mm.
All right, because she didn't like to want buy no black pepper. She said that's all the black pepper you need.
Mm-hmm.
This one thing.
Yeah, spicy. That's a lot of flavor and taste.
So what we're gonna do is just slice it up really nice and thin like this.
Mm-hmm.
All right. And I have a guard hand, right? So basically, I could just chop as much as I want and watch you, but preferably, let's not do that. All right, so we're just gonna do this.
Yeah.
And just continue the same platform again, same thing. And mm-hmm. you just do the last three for me, all right?
Okay. Hey. That fish broth, that's something like I could imagine making on a river lime or something like that.
I mean, of course, man, that is a good river. That is a river lime, that is a beach vibe, that is a everything because that is, like, for example, if for me,
mm-hmm.
growing up as a young man, my brother and I, we was just my big brother, in fact, should I say,
mm-hmm.
used to go out with his friends, right? Now, when you go on the beach and you're young, you don't want to go and spend money. So, obviously, what my brother used to do is he messaged one of his friends, tell his friends bring green fig or bring flour or bring something of the sort, lentils, we'll bring in onions, we'll bring in the vegetables, we'll bring in lime to make juice, we'll bring in sugar, even that bottle, and we'll bring in the jug.
You know?
And when we reach on the beach, whatever we catch at the time, because we have our lines in the water, so we basically get whatever we catch and they dive it as well.
Oh, all right.
So then we must get fish. That's the most important thing, that we would have definitely got fish.
Mm-hmm.
And then from it, they gut it in the water, basically getting back to the environment, you know what I'm saying, the crabs, those guts.
That's what you used to do around Juniquay all the time.
Like, that was the place to go. That was the only time for our parents to really let us go out, because we had an excuse now, you know what I'm saying? You know, my father, that's the only time my father loved that time of the year as well. Because you know, that's the time he used to make us go in the bush. That's the only time he could let my mother make us go in the bush and like do work, cut grass and just teach us more stuff. Yeah, just teach us more
stuff. Okay, I hope I didn't cut it too thin.
Nah, it's good enough.
Mm-hmm.
Right. But yeah, that's what we used to do back then, you know? That was fun.
Like buzz bamboo and different things like that.
I mean, the funny thing is, the bamboo and the eyebrows. Let me be very honest with you. Let's not say I was scared because I had a bad experience, you know what I'm saying?
What?
Yeah, because you know,
your eyebrows?
Not just my eyebrows, you know, a piece of my hair on top, you know. Because, you know, like, so growing up, right, you know, everybody wanted to take the biggest bamboo site in the river, going in the river Lima. I don't know. I was more of a home baby at first, you know what I'm saying? When I started going to secondary school, and my father and mother started giving me a little dealings, you know, like, I started going out a little more. So we went in the river, basically, we got some nice bamboos. You know, I got the biggest bamboo. I said, yeah, put that on my shoulder too. Put that bamboo on my shoulder. Yeah, man. And you know, the funny thing is that you have to add a certain amount of K oil in the bamboo. I add half of the bottle. And after I have half of the bottle, you know, you have to ignite it.
Yeah.
So when I ignited, the bamboo split, the fire come back on my face. Ever since, I don't know what's a bamboo. I don't see a bamboo. I don't hear a bamboo.
At least you're okay today. And I mean, you don't have no patches.
No, it traumatized me. I'm very traumatized. You know, I don't want to cook nothing to use. I don't want to use a bamboo bowl. That's how traumatized I am right now. I'll be very honest with you.
But you know, the bamboo charcoal, like, that's the key, like, you know, the men's skincare products and different hair products and things, it's always like a bamboo charcoal.
No, what I do is coconut oil. You know coconut oil? That's a nice thing to use. That's how locals use coconut oil. Okay, man? Use the coconut oil and the cocoa butter, it'll help you, trust me.
Alright. You want me to get that more?
No, that's perfect. So what we're going to do now, we're going to move on to most Lucian's favorite thing. Lucian's like to use that a lot for everything. We use that for antibiotics. You have a toothache, bite that and you're good to go.
Yeah, so Lucian swear on the garlic, eh?
Yeah, you need to have garlic in your food. If you don't have garlic in food, you know, share that next thing, you don't have salt in your food. That's a problem. Don't do that. So what we're going to do up is really nice and easy. We don't want to chop it and dice it too thin. Okay? Because we want it to have a nice flavor. So we're just going to continue to a nice flavor, right? Alright, and then you just get a nice little flavor again. You want to get it, like I say, too thin. We're just going to do nice little thinly. You want it too thin, but you want that nice little consistency. Alright? Alright. Weapon of choice.
Weapon of choice, that one has been too heavy for me, so I'll take that one.
I had a man
should have
tapped out eventually.
So, a cross or diagonal?
Whichever, alright, okay. So you could do it right like this, so you basically have more grip, alright? And just lightly go slice it down, so on, so on. Perfect. You could leave it so, but since I cut it up nicely already, we're going to just give it just rough chops, right? Rough, nice chops.
The gloves making it a little bit difficult, eh?
Yeah, okay, I gotta put it tight. I gotta put it tight on you, you know? I'll pull it up.
Oh.
Yeah, but I guess as it's extra large gloves as well.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah, so just rough, nice little rough chops like this. Pull it up again.
Right.
Nice rough chops. After the garlic, we're gonna move on to our onions.
Okay.
Alright.
That big onion there?
Yeah.
Let me see your skills. Show us your skills.
Show us my skills.
Yes. Show the DBS family what you can do.
Okay. So what I usually do is cut it like this.
Aye, aye, aye.
So I like this and then just go like this. Okay, we want nice rough chops. That's the goal. Rough not supposed to have perfect cuts. Rough supposed to have perfect flavor.
I like that.
If you don't have the perfect flavor,
something wrong.
Yeah, because you want to add, you want to get in between times, you want to get that taste, that bite of that onion as well. I'm going to add a lot of onion as well, all right?
Yeah. So we're putting this whole thing in there.
Yeah, we're putting all this seasoning. We're not missing not a pinch. Mm-hmm. So we're going to use all that seasoning into this as well, all
right? Right.
Most people ask me why he doesn't cry. I tell them because, you know, the tears dry up already a long time ago. When you enter that kitchen,
yeah,
you don't have tears anymore.
Me neither, you know.
I could tell you strong.
Life just, you know, it packing some punches packing on us punches. There. Yes.
And you know, the fun thing about Juni Creole is that you use those stuff a lot. You get that everywhere. If you do it as your place is Juni Creole and you get your rough cut onions like this,
Something wrong.
All right, so we're going to now take these and put this in this pan right there, which is steaming, bubbling hot right now, all right? Take our onions and our stuff. Spread it in nice like this.
Right. So let's say you don't have tuna. Is there a substitute that we can use to make this recipe?
Of course. There is. So fish broth is all depending on what fish you like. You could literally, whichever fish you like, you could use tuna. My second choice would be snapper, but I would always tell you people add the snapper last minute because snapper is a very light fish and it cooks really easy. And it's flaky, that little white meat.
Mm-hmm.
I like my red and my white meat.
I like it when it's grilled, like the snapper. You ever taste a grilled snapper?
And that's actually quail as well. So you could actually take your grilled snapper, your whole, you're not cutting the fish halfway, you're not filleting, you have to leave the bones in it. Mm-hmm. You take your red snapper, you gut it properly, scale it out, you leave it whole, take your nice seasoning, your dry seasoning. You don't have to foil it because we are foiling. Back then we had no foil. We take that, just drop it on the grill. Or drop it on a stone, a hot stone.
Mm-hmm.
And just build up a nice little bit of oil. And you
or even on your coal pot too.
But yeah, and you're good to go. All right. So since we have this added in there right now, we're going to use the parsley last. And we're going to add those stuff last. We're going to leave those to the last stuff. And then we're going to go now to our furin.
Okay.
And our avocados. Now how I like my avocados all the time is, I like my avocados when I got like, right. I don't want to be half ripe or it has to get a little mushy, not too mushy, that little bit of mushy, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
Alright. Alright, so what we're gonna do now, we're gonna cut this bad boy like this. Go around like this. Alright. And we're left with this nice inside, that nice soft inside. Alright?
Right.
Alright, what I want you to do for me right now, I want you to just start. I'm gonna give you this spoon. I want you to just try your best to scoop it out for me, right?
No problem. So we're making furin balls.
Lovely, yes.
I used to make this all the time. Every Juni Creole, if it's not pemmy I'm making, is some furin balls. Yes. When I was at school in the US, we had like this multicultural day of thanks, so kind of like a Thanksgiving dinner. And I made some furin balls for them. And oh, everyone loved the furin balls. That was one of their favorite things, so.
All right, lovely. Oh, you did a good job. So you scooped that up. So now we're gonna take this and we're just gonna drop this bad boy inside like this. All right. And now, down to our favorite. So grab this from the right up, please.
All right.
All right.
So let me see if I can open this.
Don't be afraid. And if you had to rip it, I'd rip it.
I might have to rip it.
Yeah, just we have a knife.
All right.
Cut this bad boy.
Let's rip it open.
So then how you know when you have the perfect amount of fur? It's just I get. Yes, basically you just pour until you feel like, you just feel that level of confidence. So you know, like, I mean, most foods that you have that amount of quantity, you have this scale, you have this weight of how you want something else. Creole, traditional Creole dish, we don't use any weights. We just I gauge a lot of stuff, to be very honest with you. All right, and we're just going to be mixing it with a spoon.
And if we need to add more, we add more.
Exactly. Now, what the consistency you want is it to be sort of like a dough. All right, this dish is basically furin. Furin, basically, this is furin and avocado. So what we're going to be making is called, basically, this is the furin balls. That's the basic starting of the furin balls. Basic starting, all right? So we're going to, we have the furin right over there. Got the furin right over there. All right, we have this furin right over there. And you add the furin in it, basically. When you add the furin in it, you add the avocados, and you just mix it up.
All right, so what's your favorite Creole dish?
Ooh, that's a good question. But also hard for a chef.
True, because right. You make so many dishes.
I would say my favorite Creole dish to make would have to be coconut balls.
Coconut balls.
I love sweet things. I love sweet things. But my favorite dish to eat would have to be a broth or bouillon.
Okay, okay.
I
have a question.
Talk to me.
Is
nice.
It going to be a pork bouillon, or are you staying away from the pork and do you go towards chicken or something like that?
All right. A great chef once told me, from time it's meat, we're eating it. So basically, it could be pork, it could be beef, it could be chicken. Whatever in the pot, we're eating it. All right? That's it. You're going to add. So we want this nice consistency. Good job. So she also added as well. So I didn't even have to tell her that, the consistency that we want. Mm-hmm. Basically, you want to mix it up. Mix it up really nice. Get sure you get a furin all around. I'm going to put a little more furin. It's going to take a lot more furin. If I have to give the estimate, it'll probably be like 40% avocado and the rest of the 60% would be furin.
Mm-hmm.
All right? She's doing a good job of doing that.
Let's see, we're getting there, but it needs more.
So what we're going to do right now, we're going to do the chef trick. The chef trick is just me eyeing it. I know how much I should give already. I'm just going to add it, all right? That's it. That's the consistency you want right there.
There we go. We're getting there.
Now we're about to get all hands down, okay? We're about to get some hands down, okay?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So yes. Let me ask you a question. What is your favorite Creole dish, if I'm not asking?
My favorite Creole dish would have to be a callaloo. Oh my goodness. The taste of the crab in there. I love crab. So I would definitely say that callaloo is my favorite Creole dish. And the second to that, probably a pigtail bouillon. You cannot do without a pigtail bouillon.
Salted.
That's just a
salted.
Stable.
I don't know if
staple.
It's fresh tail or you don't want salted. Yeah.
Salted.
Salted tail.
Yes,
bouillon.
There's no other way to do it.
I've been honest, you know how most people blanch their salted tail bouillon? I just blanch that. I put that in the water. I don't add any salt. Then I just give that my season. That's just my trick.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So, what we're going to do now, since we finish with this, we're going to go and take our fish.
Okay.
Now, this, we're going to be using our tuna head. I'm going to be putting all that tuna in. We don't want to leave no tuna. All right, and I basically marinated this in peppers, garlic, onion, a little bit of oil, and salt, black pepper, and basically a light bit of all-purpose seasoning as well, all right?
Okay.
So we're going to take this bad boy.
How long has it been marinated?
It is marinated. I marinate my meat every overnight. So basically the day before. So I marinated it around probably like at 12 o'clock, clear up it, put it in the fridge, put it in a nice little fridge to be chilled, not frozen, because you want that to be on the meat to absorb
it. You want it to absorb
it. Right there and there. All right.
Right.
And you could also tell that the season as well give it a like cook it a little bit. That's a salt in it. All right. So the salt as well kind of cook the first layer of the skin.
Yeah, I can kind of see it there.
Yeah. So it looks like it cooked, but it's not. It's not. All right. So we're gonna take this bottle.
Try to eat it now.
No, we're not gonna do that. So we're gonna get a big fish head. Put that in the water. All right. Because fish head has a lot of meat. All right. We Saint Lucians eat everything in the fish. The eyes, the tail. Fish don't like us. All right. I'm going to take the steak as well, for the steak, bad boy, the steak inside there as well. And then, of course, you don't want to forget your tail. Now, the thing about a broth, all right, is I'm going to put that juice in it as well, or that marination in it as well. The thing about a broth is basically, a broth is where you get that fish stock in it, so you get that full, hard flavor of the fish, which is very important. That's the most important part of it, all right? So I'm just basically going to start wrapping up and just, we're going to clear out this a little bit and then we're going to put some plates down and then we're going to head outside and we're going to be grilling this. It's going to be smoking and roasting this saltfish. We're not going to blanch it. We're going to leave it as it is. I'm going to go on our coal pot outside and roast this bad boy. All right. So see
okay,
you guys
awesome. On. Well, we'll see you guys soon and we'll meet back on the stove.
All right.
Forward of this broth. So
all right, so what we're gonna do right now is that basically, like she said, we basically roast it up. So this is that's how you're gonna have, that's what's gonna be left with. All right, And if you just pass your hand on it, you could just basically move the skin of it really easy because of how it is. And you can see that juice inside of it.
Mm-hmm.
I would jade eat this right now, and I'll just let me know what you think about it. I would honestly jade eat it right now.
Okay, all right.
It's gonna have a kick. It's gonna have a kick.
It's good. It's good. It's already tasting great.
I have a weak stomach, man. It has a punch to it, but it's really good though, because you have that smoky texture from it.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so basically, just going to remove as much bones as possible from it. All right. And the good thing about it is, since the skin is burned out already, you don't have to worry about which head on it. You just take, you can scope it out mm-hmm. easy like this. It's a fun thing to do at home as well. You could use a stove to do it. Just put it over your burner, your stove, and do it from your stove as well. So it's not something that you need a coal pot for if you don't have one. The coal pot is just a fun experience, to be honest, because it's mm-hmm. fun to try and catch it on fire. I promise you that.
As right. It's this season, we have to use our local equipment.
Right is right. She's not wasting no saltfish, I see.
No.
All right. So what we're going to do now is we're going to take our furring balls.
Yes.
Our furring avocado, because it's not furring balls yet. So that's the way we roll it up.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to make a little nudge in it. So press it out like this. All right, we're gonna take our saltfish. And if you feel a bone, please move it. We ain't trying to choke nobody, okay? All right, so we're gonna just go like this. Cup it up. Nice round bowl like this. And you will feel the bones in it. That's a good thing about it. All right, nice round bowl like this. All right.
And what are we gonna do now?
It's basically already done.
Okay.
Lovely.
Super easy.
Super
it's not
easy,
hot at all.
Really quick. If you have to make it at home, it might take you 15 to 10 minutes maximum.
Mm-hmm.
All right, take that fern ball again. Let's get this done.
But I like this smoky flavor because you can't get that from a stove. You can't get it at all.
Well, you can't get that smoky, that really nice smoky flavor from the stove, to be honest. But what you could get is you could tell it's still roasted. So if mm-hmm. you are happen and you're probably overseas right now, and you don't have one, you could always use a smoker, you could always use a grill, but you can never miss that taste and that flavor from the whole pot. I'm telling you,
yes.
It's a different flavor.
So everyone at home, I dare you to try to make it on your stove. Try to roast that saltfish on your stove and see how it comes out.
I guarantee you guys, you will not regret it. It's a really fun recipe, especially mm-hmm. for the kids. If you mm-hmm. have kids and you want to make them do something fun and interesting.
Speaking of fun recipes, have
yes.
you ever done any fun, you know, arts with your food or anything
yes,
interesting?
Yes, so I have done arts with your food. There this competition we had when we was in Martinique.
Mm-hmm.
And there is this French set of guys, and the first time I actually ate grasshopper, actually.
Grasshopper,
okay. Yeah. For it to have a kick of a flavor,
mm-hmm.
honestly, not really much of a kick. It was just like neutral.
Right.
A little crispiness to it. But I mean, watching those chefs create something and create the art form of culinary arts was amazing. That was one of my best experiences ever in the kitchen industry.
Mm-hmm.
Honestly. All right, so since we're done with our furring balls, because that was the last one.
We're done with our furring balls.
And one way to know if you have the right amount of furring is this. It doesn't stick on your hand. All right, if it sticks in your hand, that means you don't have enough furring. All right, so what we're about to do now is we're gonna put this away. All right, what we're gonna do now is we're gonna start seasoning the broth because it's boiling.
All right, let's get these flavors
we're gonna
underway.
Add my favorite all-purpose seasoning. This is my preference. You don't have to if you want. This is my favorite all-purpose seasoning. Gonna give this a little sprinkle in between times.
Mm-hmm.
All right, nice light work of it.
And some salt. Sea salts.
So I use sea salt. I use
kosher salt.
Sorry.
Okay.
And then we're just gonna put a bit of kosher inside of it. So you could use sea salt or kosher salt. I love kosher salt. All right.
Mm-hmm. Kosher salt. I know it has some religious aspects to it as well.
And health
the way
benefits.
They make it.
A lot of health benefits as well.
Mm-hmm.
It's not like the regular ones. All right.
Right. So.
So what we're about to do right now?
Yes.
Is we're gonna be cutting this up open. I'm gonna basically open this and then we're gonna just put both of those actual buckets in it.
Okay.
Alright? Because we want to get that rich flavor from it.
Mm-hmm.
Alright. So what I'm gonna do right now is basically just take this right easy like this. And I'm going to basically just open this real quick, and we're going to just add it inside of this flavor thing right there. But I'm just going to take the same spoon I had with the furry, same spoon I have with furry, and I'm just going to mix it in it nicely.
Does the furry do anything to the taste?
It's balanced out. So basically, right? Be mindful, you're going to be using that same furry as a deep with it. So you're going to be, you know how they have fufu? The Africans have fufu.
Yeah.
All right. So basically, this is going to be our fufu with our broth.
Okay. All right?
So it's going to be a very fun, and you're going to have different textures and different flavors in your mouth, which is mostly, basically, to me, it's going to be very fun.
So there's no problem with mixing the recipes together?
None using at all. The same equipment? I mean, I wouldn't tell you put it in it like a dumpling. Don't do that. But it's not a problem if mixing it up at all.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So let's cut these open.
I'm going to cut this open.
I don't need that.
Okay, she's a strong girl.
All right, you want me to just dump it in there?
Dump it in right there. Perfect.
There we go.
Take this Maggi and just sprinkle it around like this. Ooh.
All right. All right.
Balance flavor now. We go back with the spoon again.
Stir and it up real nice. Mix it all together.
Mix it all up together. All right. And you're going to get this nice color, this nice thickness of it. It's not going to be too watery. It's not going to be too thick because you have that starch in it as well.
It has that fish broth look. Like, you know, there's a specific look to a fish broth compared to some other meats.
Yeah. I mean, some people as well add curry to their fish broth as well. I, however, not really a big curry fan, honestly.
Yeah.
But you can add curry to it as well. It's very flavorful as well. All right.
All right.
So I'm going to just exchange my boards real quick, and then we're going to go off to my other board. I'm going to start off with our my favorite of all things to be used.
And what's
this
that?
Is basically carrots and cabbages. Call me.
So we're going to be peeling some carrots.
Yeah. So call me the rabbit man because I love me some carrots.
I'll call you Bugs Bunny instead.
Call me Bugs Bunny because I love me my carrots. So she's already peeling for me, so that's good. And I over here.
Some carrots. Honestly, I prefer growing my own carrots.
Really?
Yes, I have a carrot farm at home. I have my little carrot patch, and they're so sweet. But they're baby carrots, honestly. But putting it in my food, I don't know, it adds something different to it. So
amazing. That's good. All right. So while she does this, I'm going to take my little pan like this, and I'm going to grate my carrot. Now, if you want the perfect long strips, all you do is one at a time. So you go one strip down. You don't go back and forth. If you go back and forth, it's always a problem. It's always a, you know, a little problem. If you do it like this, you get shorter rolls. But when you go like one,
you gotta go all the way.
You go all the way down. You get this nice.
Are we gonna be using the whole half of a cabbage today?
We're gonna be using half of the cabbage today. Half of the half.
Okay.
All right. I'm gonna be going down sewing it. Careful.
There we go.
All right. Get this bad boy inside her.
And the way you want me to cut it, is there a special way you want your flicks to be?
Yeah, so let me show you this. This is a very tricky and fun part of it. All right, so what I'm going to do right now, I'm going to just go like this.
You want to get it thin.
Yeah. I mean, you can use a mandolin if you don't want to. I mean, it's all depending on your preference. And it doesn't really matter how thin as you have it, honestly. Because most times they actually cut it big in the broth, put in the broth.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I'll show you, I'll be showing you why I'm going to be cutting it this way. You will see why I'm cutting it this way at the end.
Promise. Okay.
All right.
I'll remember to ask you that closer to the end.
Yeah. So we're just going to be cutting it like this, roughly. Right. Nice. I'm going to actually mix it with the carrots. All right.
I could tell you love cooking. I could tell this is your passion. What got you into cooking?
What got me into cooking was actually me growing up with my grandmother. My grandmother used to live at Cleary. I used to live Timon Union. And it was just a really fun experience, like me growing up with my grandmother. And she was always on a stool, and I was always between her legs, right? And she used to just peel a garlic. And she used to sing her songs and just have a little, rather she have a shot of a Bounty with coconut next to her, right there. My grandmother used to love a Bounty and coke, right? And she would just peel her seasonings. I could always remember, I can actually smell it right now. She loved fresh seasoning, and she used to love box.
box?
Chicken box was the lady's favorite thing.
That's her thing.
Chicken box and breadfruit was the lady's favorite thing.
Mm-hmm.
You could have bring a KFC, she bring you that. You could have bring her $1,000, I like she got to keep it. But she would have loved, honestly, but she's deceased, so I mean, I'm just leaving up on the legacy, honestly. She wasn't one of those wealthy people, but everybody, the water was wealthy to everybody, and she was always giving it to everybody in the community. Everybody in Clary would know Miss Yuyu or Mama Yuyu or Miss Alice. Because like she was basically a very, very, very nice lady. And she would basically help everybody. I mean, her house was a shelter house if you needed hurricane. Something happened at your hurricane, you go down to her, and she always opened her home to everybody. So again, me seeing that also inspired me to become a chef, and also for me to be able to help others as well. Speaking of helping others as well, so what we do, what I do as well, is I go to schools, secondary schools as well. And since I know CXE coming up, I go back and give the schools back the time, because I mean, some children probably pay more attention to the chef. So I do that as well. So because of that, again, because my grandmother and the experience I have, I want to give back because of her. So thank you, Granny.
That's very noble of you to continue her legacy. All right.
So since we add this in right now, this is basic. So the trick about this right now, this is basically cooked already. The broth is already cooked. Now what we're going to do right now is we're going to add these vegetables in it last minute. The vegetables last in it for 4 or 3 minutes, all depending on how you want your crunch. If you want to stay longer, you can up to 5 minutes. I live it up to 3 to 5 minutes, 4 minutes sometimes, right?
Okay.
So this is why too, you're going to live it up last and you're going to see why. We might tell I'm going to do a little bit of gourmet style.
Yeah,
so
of course.
So since I cut it up like this, we're going to put it on top and you're going to see the end results of it, all right? So if you could get past me my spoon, please.
Sure.
All right, and basically we're going to just be stirring it real quick. As you can still see my furin at the back of it. And the trick of it as well is I want to make sure if anything is sticky at the bottom, I can feel it. All right, if my furin move on my bottom of my spoon, something's sticking, which is not good. All right. So that's the reason why I have my furin. All right, so I'm going to be mixing it in it. All right. Oh my goodness. It looks good. It looks really good. Alright, so basically what happened right now there, most of our starch is also melted in it. So that is going to help our texture get it's going to be a little more thicker. Alright, so what we're going to be doing right now is I'm going to get us a bowl. We're going to clay up there a little bit.
Okay.
And we're going to get a bowl. And then once we get that bowl, we're going to start plating this food because I'm hungry.
Alright, me too. I want to taste what Chef K's dishes taste like. I want to see... how we do it on the rocks. Everyone wants to see. Saint Lucia wants to see. That's right. All right. So we're cleaning up now, and I can't wait to see the end product and how you cutting up the cabbage so thinly is gonna make it gourmet style.
Yes, it's going to be very interesting. It's going to be fun. I promise you this.
Okay.
All right. So let me just clear this on this side.
And now plating this, is there a special way that you would plate the fish broth, especially since you have kind of like a dip in the recipe? Is there a way?
Yes, I'm going to show you that way too. It's fun.
Okay.
And another thing you could use as well is, you know, back then we have a lot of things we do. We have Creole, we roast our local bread, and we also roast bakes. All right. So what you can do as well, when you finish roasting your bake as well, you add some butter and some garlic in a pan. To basically let the butter melt out of it. As soon as the butter melts out with the garlic, you off the pan and let it sit. And then you take that, you cut your roasted bake or your bread in half, dip it in it, put it in a flat pan or any pan to just basically get it crispy on it. And use it with your fish broth. I can guarantee you will never forget. So right now we're just gonna chop this up real thin.
Right.
And we're basically gonna use this as garnish as well. All right, so that's real nice and thin.
So look at how thin he's chopping it up. Look at the texture of it. He's gonna be using it as garnish, so it needs to be as thin as possible.
Yeah. I also watch some chefs do as well. They actually fry it, put it in hot oil for like 350 degrees. And it's gonna give it a crisp, and then we cut it, put it in underneath the heat, and it's gonna get really nice and crispy. This is another trick, a method that's more in the feel of when you wanna get a nice, but we want a nice fresh texture, because again we want to use that fresh texture for our fresh and basically our nice Creole dish. All right, so I'm just going to skip out there.
And as we go along, do you know the Creole name for this recipe?
Creole name for it?
Yes.
Honestly, no. What I do know it has, and I've always known it has, was fish broth. All right, I know fish in part where is poisson.
Poisson.
Poisson, mm-hmm. All right? But we're basically going to make it some nice poisson broth, okay?
Okay.
All right, so what we're going to do now is I'm going to take my pan, all right? And I'm going to place my pan right here to start plating.
Okay.
All right, so we're going to take this pan like this.
Mm-hmm.
Place right here.
Now let's just watch him demonstrate his plating methods and how he would serve this dish.
All right. So I'm actually using a spoon with a funnel for now. With basically holes, basically, for now. And I'll show you why. Because I want to get my fish properly placed in my bowl. All right. Now, as well, if you want to know if your fish broth is cooked too, I'm going to use the word perfection. You're not going to see any head again in your broth, because your head is going to melt properly and really nice in your broth. It's one way to make sure it's cooked to perfection. All right, so we have our green fig, we have our dashing, mm-hmm. We have our potatoes.
All these different elements.
All these different starches.
Coming in to add to the flavor.
I'm telling you, you can't regret this flavor, all right?
Mm-hmm.
All right, we're going to take this bad boy.
The steak. Gonna put it on top, okay.
Yes. Remember I told you I cut my thing for a specific reason?
Yes.
I'm gonna place it like this. Alright. Look for my vegetables properly.
So it's all part of the plating process and the delivery.
Yes. Alright. Put it like this. And we're not gonna forget about anything, promise you. We're not gonna leave that sauce. We're gonna go back to that sauce. But afterwards, mm-hmm. Alright? Take this, like this, like this. And we're looking for this bad boy tail.
The tail
we're looking for. I saw him a while ago.
You can't forget the tail. I got him right there.
He tried to run.
The skin is fallen all the way off. You can't even recognize that it's the tail anymore.
Take this again. All right, come back in. Go again, same method.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Then we look for that tail again.
And you're going to put it on top.
I'm going to put this tail. All right, so. All right, guys.
Right.
Now, we're going to go in.
With the cabbage.
For our cabbage.
And carrots.
All that good stuff on top of this, like this.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Now, I'm going to go and take my ladle. I'm going to scoop it up and put some sauce in it, all right?
All right. The ladle. Let's see what instrument the ladle is.
So basically a sauce spoon. We're going to take this right quick. Alright. Alright, take it up nicely. We're basically going to gently pour it down.
All the way over.
Alright, so.
Look at that, St. Lucia. Look at how delicious that looks. I don't know about you, but I'm excited to taste this. So I'm hoping you're following along and you are making this recipe as well, so when we eat, you're gonna enjoy with us.
For sure. Please do take your time, make it with the kids will enjoy it.
Mm-hmm.
Especially if your kids don't like vegetables, I can promise you they'll like it that way, because I didn't like vegetables growing up. But when I see a fish broth, woo!
It's something different, right?
Now we're going to take out a little bit of garnish, nicely spread on top of it like this.
You're gonna add all of that on there.
And then
put it to the side.
To the side. And this is it, St. Lucia. This is our fish broth. Our St. Lucian fish broth. Let's have a little bit of Quincy's.
Perfectly plated. So guys, now we're gonna go ahead to the table and try this out. See you there.
Alright, see you guys.
So guys, we have our food and we're ready to dive in, DBS family. Just look at how beautiful this meal is prepared by Chef K here today. And down to the garnish, to the steak, to the farine ball, everything just looks so well put together. you know?
Thank you.
So, you have anything to add on there, Chef K, before we dive in?
I can say, guys, it's a really fun, easy local dish to prepare. It's one of my favorite dishes to get. I mean, you get it mostly. This is one of the local dishes and that you'll get anytime on Saturdays if you buy a local bar or have a kitchen. It's just a really easy, fun thing to eat that will fill your stomach. And it's very nutrition as well. I love nutrition as well, benefits as well. It's really amazing, especially for us men. All right.
Okay. And how do you eat this? I know you mentioned like you kind of eat it like the African fufu.
Yeah, so again, so I'm a chef, I don't like getting my hands too much. But mm-hmm. what we're going to do is basically you're going to just dip this sauce in this right there. You're going to take a spoon.
Right.
Get that sauce in, dip this in like this. All right.
Mm-hmm.
And just put the mouth by big bite in.
Look at the inside, guys. Look at all the saltfish.
And you have this perfect, nice, not too thick sauce. And it just goes really good.
The sauce is perfect. The taste is amazing. And let's get down to our actual tuna fish. The actual tuna fish steak, piece of steak we have here. So let's see.
Got me my tail.
Put a little bit of the cabbage on there because that's the main part of the recipe. Very soft. That's the first thing I'm thinking of. The actual fish meat is very soft and delicious. The taste is impeccable. I mean, chef, you outdid yourself today.
I appreciate that. I gotta say, this dish again is not just inspired me. The reason why I thought of it instantly right away was because again of my grandmother. She liked her buyo, she liked her green fish, she liked her box, she loved fish. And this is just something that I could tell you that I could relate to doing with her. So this dish wasn't truly done by myself.
Mm-hmm.
If I have to be honest, it's done by her.
You got inspired by your ancestors, your St. Lucian ancestors.
Ground root. Yeah, my grandmother is born raised St. Lucian. And the balls, again, that's from my father's side. So I just tried to implement it both sides of the farm. It's my mom's side with the broth.
Mm-hmm.
My dad's side with the balls, with the avocado and the foreign balls, if you want to say that, mm-hmm. and the roasted saltfish. It's a dish, like I say, which has inspired me by my family, and I hope that you enjoy it, and I hope you guys enjoy it. It's a really easy meal to do, guys, so let me know when you try it, let me know how it is. Mm-hmm.
If there is any dish that I will ask you guys to make, it's this one here today. So I hope you guys do. Thank you for joining us today, and we'll see you in the next episode.
Bye.
Don't let anybody.